I'm going to name my kid King Henry VIII.
You've been rumored to be with Prince Harry for the last 6 years.
Really? Oh my God, that's so exciting. I know. I always feel like the tabloid rumors are like this other life I live, where like I'm getting in fights with people who I've never met, but I'm like, okay. Like, I've never met Prince Harry, but we're dating, so I'm like, more.
The secret life.
Yeah, exactly.
Is it harder to do this or to go run and shoot arrows and do all that stuff?
This. Yeah. But I mean, I sweat more doing the other thing, but.
But the press, is it press itself, or is it just the schedule of something like a festival where you're premiering and going to the party and going to the thing?
Yeah, it's just like a really stressful kind of, it's a lot to do. And you don't really realize how draining it is, you know, just kind of nonstop talking about yourself. Nobody should ever talk about themselves that much.
So you're
not
still
psychologically healthy.
So you're still off of talking of your, you're not really, you haven't changed. In your huge success of the last few
years. I still hate talking about myself, yes. No, but it started to do this terrible thing where somebody will ask a question and I'll just automatically go to answer it, and then somebody will be like, they're talking to me. And I'm like, oh God, I'm turning into one of those people.
Well, it's hard with everybody constantly kind of chasing you down for things.
Yeah.
It must be a relief to go to another country to shoot a movie. To just
yeah, where nobody cares, nobody knows.
Yeah.
It's great.
So this movie, how did you end up being Bradley's paramour in this one? I guess you guys have been married twice now in two movies.
Yeah.
So you which was before which?
This was first.
So this, you got together, and then the next one you get married? You're married, you start?
Yeah. Yeah. So it's actually kind of like the progression of a real relationship.
That's right.
We're just dating in the first movie, and then we're married in the next movie.
And the divorce movie will be
yeah,
next.
And then we have the divorce coming out. It'll be the box set.
So how did David just get in touch with you and...
No, I had, I've been a huge David O. Russell fan, like, since I started learning about film, and my agents knew this, and there was this movie, and they weren't considering me, because I'm completely wrong for the part, way too young, and I just kind of went on Skype, and read with David, and then I met him in New York, and kind of forced him to hire me.
So I guess Bradley was in place first, if you were?
No, it was actually Mark Wahlberg at the time, and then Bradley and I had a hilarious phone conversation where he was like, I'm not Mark Wahlberg. And and then we just kind of hit it off right away. And then you see him on set, or you see him perform, and it's just, you can't imagine it being anybody else. He's his performance is perfection.
So did you have to age up in some way, or did you just?
I probably should have, but we never really bothered with it. We were just like, well, it's just gonna be one of those things. People are just gonna have to accept it.
Well, I think you accept it in the movie because of you. I think there's an energy to your performance that is so kind of grounded and strong.
Thank you.
That you push through the age thing right away.
Oh, good, thanks, that's good to hear.
So that wasn't a consideration, wasn't a discussion with David, wasn't, you know, try to do this or try to do that, or just focus on the script?
It wasn't, yeah. There was never like, act older, except like when we weren't shooting.
So when you went chasing David, was it the script that was dragging you in, or was it?
No,
really,
it was just David. And then I said I wanted to do the movie. Like I said, yes, I want that movie before I even read the script because of David. And then I read the script and was like, yes, yes, please.
So the biggest challenge was the dancing? Was that the impression I got last night?
Yeah.
You told the entire world, don't judge my dancing.
God, I'm such a terrible dancer. And I feel so bad for Bradley because he's actually really good, and he's really smart, so he can see somebody like do a dance move and be like, oh, and like do that. And I'm like, I'm going to need 3 weeks at least.
So you do a lot of training for it?
We rehearsed for about 2 weeks before we started shooting, like a couple hours a day. He didn't have to do as much because he was better than me. I had to have extra homework.
So did you come to like it at all, or did you just?
It's once you know a dance, then it's fun because you can actually like, you can like dance. Mm-hmm. But I by no means was mistaken that I knew I was terrible the whole time. It was just fun anyway.
So how was the experience of being directed by David finally?
Oh, amazing! Like a dream come true. Because when you're such a huge fan of somebody, you build it up so much in your head, you're always prepared to be let down. But he was just the nicest, warmest, sweetest like person in the entire world. Just has such a warm, good energy. And then he just directs in this. I've never worked that way. And that's such an incredible thing to do, is to kind of realize that there's no one or right way to make a movie or direct an actor.
So what did he do, something that you particularly like that you haven't done?
Yeah, he would interrupt like any monologue, no matter what it was, no matter how serious, he would go, oh, it's such bullshit, it's so bad, it's so bad. Just like, be like, all right, let's do it again. It's just like so funny to be able to, like, because you can be honest, like, on this whole new level. Like, that's why Bradley and I, like, don't want to stop working together, because we can just be like, don't say that, don't wear that, what are you doing? Like, just boss each other around. I like him not wasting time and just like cutting the bullshit and just getting real. And because I feel like everybody always treats actors like, as they probably should, emotional like landmines. Everybody's always like tiptoeing around because you never know what's going to set them off. And it's just a job like any other. Like, sometimes you're going to be good and sometimes you're going to be bad. Like, just, I like it when somebody's like, that was bad, do it again.
So when he's saying that, he's not just saying it about, he's saying it mostly about you guys, not about his script or...
No, it's never about his script. It's always about our performance.
You just missed the mark.
Yeah, no, he'll just be like, you were really bad.
So did he interrupt Nero like that, or is it just...
He would. I don't think he would be ashamed to do that at all, but I don't think he had to. It's Robert De Niro.
So was there anything else you had to do for this? I mean, you run a lot, but I guess you're running a lot anyway.
I had to gain weight, which was amazing because I had just wrapped The Hunger Games. So then a director pulls me into his office and is like, I want you to, you know, gain some weight. And I was like, no problem. I'll get right on that. And then at the end of the movie, he goes, you're going to be wearing tight spandex pants and a belly shirt, which is normally the exact opposite order of things. Gain weight, you're going to wear a belly shirt. So that was awesome.
So was it fun to watch when you see yourself in the belly shirt?
I can't. Like, it's mostly just the dancing. It's not even, I know I was sucking in, so I'm okay with the belly shirt. I just like can't watch myself dance like that. I mean, I do because I'm a masochist, but oof.
So you watched last night at the premiere?
I did. Yeah, that was my first time that I didn't cover my eyes.
So you've seen it before a couple times? Or?
Yeah. This was the first time, like with all the proper music and... this was a different version.
And people laughing.
Yeah, I know, with an audience, it's so great.
Did you know it was that funny?
Yeah, I did. I didn't realize it was that heartwarming, though. Like, that was something that David completely did on his own. Like, it was just, I saw it, and it was just kind of this lovely, heartwarming kind of beast. And I had always just seen it as kind of sarcastic and dark comedy kind of thing.
So. And so did the audience change your perspective on that, or did you just feel it yourself?
Probably both. And then they clapped after the dance, which was like, it almost brought tears to my eyes. That was so exciting. I was like, they feel sorry for me. That's so nice.
Well, the thing is, it's not the dance, it's the spirit of doing the dance, not the dance itself, that really the audience is in love with.
Yeah.
And is it weird to have an audience love you so much? Has it gotten stranger?
Yeah, I know. I was never sitting in the theater going, God, this audience loves me so much. That's so weird. That thought has never crossed my mind. No, it's amazing to sit with the people that you work so hard, like all of these people that put their blood, sweat, and tears into this film, and have an audience react like that and really love it. It's like, I couldn't stop squeezing David. I felt like a stage mother. I was like, listen, they love you.
So does your attitude, I mean, you are a unique specimen in this business in terms of, you seem to still be sane.
I seem that way.
Well, you were saying, I mean, the last time we talked, it was around Winter's Bone, and you were, you know, heading towards your Oscar nomination, and that was, you were already keeping your sanity in place. It was already surprising.
Was I?
I think for you, you know, you were already still talking like a human being and not like a, you know, you weren't waiting for your
tea like
to
be
served.
Not like an
artist. An artiste.
An artiste.
You're gonna put your little thing at the end.
Yes.
And now you've had this small success with The Hunger Games. But are you setting the tone for the things you're doing? And do you think that kind of openness you were talking about with David is something that you bring to a set as well?
Is there something that I bring to a set?
In terms of normalcy, sanity, and not the diva thing.
I hope so. I don't really, I think that like, for an actor to act like a diva, like, I just think that's like such a joke. Like, if I was a doctor and like saving people's lives every day, I would be so much more of an asshole. But like, I have no right. Like, I'm the luckiest person in the entire world to do what I do. And it doesn't seem like that important, so I can't like brag about it.
But you must have been around some of that over the years.
I've been really lucky with everybody that I've worked with, actually. I haven't really worked with any nightmares, you know, knock on wood. yeah, everybody that I've worked with so far has been like really wonderful and down to earth.
Well, now you kind of have the position from which you can decide what nightmares you want to work with.
Exactly.
Or not work with, yeah. Or all of that.
Now I kind of want to work with one just to see what it's like.
Just start experimenting.
Yeah.
Who can I work with?
Yeah, just start testing them to see how far I can push it.
That would be a good National Enquirer story. A little complex.
Yeah, I'm bored. I'm going to just piss off a director.
So do you, like, making the choice of Francis Lawrence for Hunger Games, for instance? I mean, you had some choice in that, I assume.
Fortunately, I never said I don't want Francis. I don't think that would have changed things. I mean, it was always they were nice enough to discuss it with me, but I don't think I have any pull in it. But I don't think. Maybe I should test that. No.
Well, the funny thing is the choice.
Brilliant choice.
He's such an actor's director. I mean, you talk to actors who've worked with him, even in things that you think are not necessarily going to be the thing they love.
Well, that was the one thing that every actor that has ever worked for him is in love with him and adores him, and that goes a long way. He's such a great director because he's freeing, but he also, you feel like you're in good hands. Like, you know that he knows the material, he knows your character, he knows why he's asking you to do something, and he's not restricted in any way. Like, we were shooting a scene, and then halfway through shooting it, he was like, here, hold this. And like, it was just like, it's not going to match anything, but he was just like, I think it's cool. You know what I mean? Like, it's nice to not feel like you've got that, you know, strict rule set.
So are you feeling on a bit of a treadmill these days? Or is this the career that you want, to be working a lot and doing this much? I mean, is that what you've been working towards the whole time? Or?
You know, I wouldn't think so. I've always been such a homebody, and I've never really liked being away from home that much and working that I like to give myself months off. But I think since fame, I don't really like being in LA, which is unfortunate because that's my home, but I don't really like it there. Like, I don't really feel like I've got a life there. Mm-hmm. So I think since Hunger Games came out, I haven't really wanted to stop. I'm happier on the go and working.
Do you think you'll ever get comfortable with fame?
I can't tell if that's a good thing or a bad thing, to finally get used to it. I mean, it's never like kind of an... Fame is such a predictable, simple thing that it's hard to be awestruck by it. Like, it doesn't impress me at all. It's a very predictable thing. You put somebody's face on a billboard and everybody thinks that they're, you know, an alien, and treats them differently and thinks that they're special when they're not. It's, you know, if we put your face everywhere and you came out with a movie and everybody started, it would be the same thing for you. Like, it's not, I'm not special. It's just, that's how fame works. So it's a very easy thing to wrap your head around. It's just, how do you deal with it? Do you trade cars? Do you, like, I have to get, like, how to be famous for dummies, because I obviously have to move out of my condo because I don't have a gate. I've got, like, fan mail coming to my front door. Like, I've been driving the same Volkswagen, so they obviously know it and can follow me everywhere. I just have to get better about things like that.
Are you concerned about it going away, or is that actually...
No, that's actually a peaceful thought for me when I start to get anxiety, when I keep looking. You know, it's not easy for a girl, but, you know, a young girl to look in a rearview mirror and be chased and followed by 15 men, even when you know that they're not, you know that it's safe, but like, I think your body doesn't really, and it's scary. Like, I always knew it would be annoying, but I didn't think it would be scary. And the only thought that comforts me is I can't be relevant forever.
Is there anything good about it?
There's a lot of great things about it. I mean, I can't... This is what I wanted to do. I mean, I'm not... I don't mean to sound ungrateful. I get to do this. I get to act. I get to make movies. You know, just being followed is a downside. But I also... It's not everywhere I go. I get free clothes. There's a lot of great things. Nice hotel rooms.
Well, part of it, I mean, in terms of your being special or not special, I mean, a big part of, I think, what all this is there is an inherent... There's part of you that is a big part of it in this case. I mean, the movie screen, the television screen also, but in a different way. But the movie screen, really, you have to be, in some ways, what that person is you're looking at. So the likability factor and the kind of the groundedness that people feel about you and connect with you and want to be like you is, you know, there is some reality in there.
Thank you.
It's not just a billboard.
Well, I'm going to keep blaming it on that damn billboard.
Do you think that you changed at all, or do you think that this parts just happened, you know, things started falling in line with Winter's Bone and have gone there since.
I haven't really changed at all because I don't really think it's, it doesn't feel like me. It's like I've made these movies that I was lucky to get hired. You know, I was really happy that they cast me in that movie and then blown away when we got into Sundance and then all of a sudden walking out the red carpet for that movie, the Oscars. It's like, it's incredible. It feels like it's such amazing events happening to me, but it doesn't feel like something I did. It's something that I feel lucky, not really responsible for.
So you don't feel like you hit a place, a maturity level or something that where you, that's that energy, the energy we know you for, became more a part of you. It just was there and you.
Which energy are you talking about?
The Jen Lawrence energy. I don't know how to even describe it anymore.
What, loud and deep voiced?
Well, part of it.
But
you hold the screen. I mean, no, I'm just like wondering whether there is obviously a huge, you were working for years before this all happened, where fame became such a big issue. And it now seems to be unstoppable at the moment. It's like everything you do has
this there's
kind
no
of
going back.
patina. Well, the thing is, this movie is going to be, a very successful movie.
Thank
and
you.
It's a different kind of performance for you. And it's like, oh, look, she can do this other thing, too, and get another nomination and do all these other things for this kind of movie is exciting. I mean, it's like another, like, oh, okay. It's a growth spurt, another growth spurt.
Yeah.
But then I wonder whether it's a growth spurt for you. Or whether it just feels like I'm just doing my work and I'm moving forward and this is who I've been forever.
Yeah, it just feels like work. Like, it just feels like a job. I mean, I'm blown away by how much everybody loves a movie and how nice everyone's being. That's so great. But I didn't feel like extra mature on that set. It's kind of same old idiot coming to work every day.
So is being an idol to young girls difficult in that regard? I mean, do you feel like
no? I mean, fortunately, I'm a grandmother, so there wasn't really. I like to pretend that there were lots of lifestyle changes that I had to make for being a role model. But I'm like, when I'm out at 11:30, I'm like, why don't these kids ever get tired? I'm not. So it's not really. It's definitely something to be aware of. I know that, you know, it does, you know. It's something that I'm very much aware of, but I haven't really made any lifestyle changes, which is a slightly embarrassing.
So in this movie, getting into this character, did you do any research? Is it just the what's on the page and doing the character? Because she is complicated in terms of her own issues.
Yeah, she's
Bradley's very a little more prescribed, I guess.
She's an onion.
Yeah.
I've never really researched a movie. That's a terrible thing to say. I don't mean to.
Well, everybody does it differently. It's not.
Yeah, I that's my excuse. I'm like when it's late at night and I'm like eating a bag of potato chips and I have to work the next day and the script's all the way over there and I don't want to pick it up. I'm like, well, it's my process. I can't show up to work prepared tomorrow. That's not how I work. That's not how I prepare.
I'm gonna write a book someday called The Potato Chip Process.
Yeah, exactly. Do as little as possible. Yeah, no, I didn't really. I just kind of, I read the script and I thought she was hilarious and just kind of went with it. And obviously David, it's such a collaboration that that I felt like there's only so much I can do until I start working with Bradley and you get on set. And David also doesn't like working, you know, he says that he doesn't like bedroom performances where actors, you can tell that it's like, oh, it was great when they were practicing in their bedroom at the hotel, and then they show up, and it's like so prepared. So we actually worked great together from that sense, because I showed up not having no idea what I was doing, totally ready.
So there are a lot of options on that he shot? I
mean, yeah, Bradley said it perfectly. We could have made 7 different movies with everything. We just did it different every time, and then I think that was why when they cut it together and I saw it, it just like had a completely different, you know, feel to it.
So is that what David wants, I guess, is, you know, give me 5 different versions of it, or?
Yeah, or he's, you know, if we do it one way and it works, then he's, then we move on. He's very instinctual, you know, he's just, if he thinks we can go here, we go there. If he thinks it's fine, we stay, but we just, it's very freeing.
So what's it like to come back to it at this point? Is it, it's been probably a year? How long has it been since you shot this?
Yeah, Thanksgiving last year, yeah.
So Is it fun to come back? Is it?
Yeah, it's really fun, but it's always nerve-wracking. I get the same feeling when I'm about to do press for a movie that I do going to film it. Like when I go film a movie, I'm like, do I have any idea what I'm doing? Like, am I ready? Like I have the script, but and then I was like in the cab on the way from the airport here, and I was like, I haven't talked about this movie. Like, what am I gonna say? I always feel like such a bad like professional, because I feel like if you guys just ask me like, what was it like working with David O. Russell, I'll be like, like I just get the same feeling of like unprepared flutters in my stomach.
Did somebody ask you the question?
What's it like working with David? Well, I actually asked myself the easiest question. I mean, it's amazing working with David. I think it's the like really artistic questions that just totally throw me through a loop. And they're like, what do you hope audiences take away from like the characters of so much? And I don't even understand what they're saying, but I can't go, what? I'm just like, oh, I think. And I just like have to talk around in circles and circles. And I'm like staring at my publicist like, am I doing okay? Making sense.
And does she always say yes, or is she something?
No, she never says yes.
So what's the worst question you've gotten this year?
Oh God, probably what grand lady would you like to play in the past? Because I said Bridget Jones. And the worst part was, I didn't even think about it. Like, it just, like, came right out, which means that's really how I feel. Like, that was my first instinct. Like, a grand old lady, Bridget Jones. That is so humiliating. That was, like, when somebody asked me, when I was doing press for Hunger Games, they were like, if you could interview anybody in the entire world, who would it be? And I just, Hulk Hogan just fell out of my mouth. I was just like, Hulk Hogan. And I was like, oh, my God, can we take that? Like, Obama. I don't know. I just had to say, like, King Henry VIII.
I like Hulk Hogan as an answer, though.
Yeah, there's so much I want to know.
You want to delve into the depth of Hulk Hogan?
Yeah, exactly.
While eating potato chips.
Yeah. I don't know enough about Hulk Hogan.
Did you grow up my biggest watching regret wrestling? In life. Are you a wrestling fan?
No. I don't. I've never seen him wrestle. I don't know why Hulk Hogan just came out of my. I mean, I know why Bridget Jones came out of my mouth, because that movie's the best. Hulk Hogan, like. I don't know where that came from.
Well, you know, they could ramp that up for you in about 6 years.
I'm like crying from myself, just from embarrassment. God.
But they really could relaunch Bridget Jones around you. That would, like, if you say this enough times, they'll go do it.
That's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to make it to 100.
Between Harvey and Bevan and Fellner being all around. Yeah, well,
if you're friends with Harvey Weinstein, like, you can have anything you want. Yes. Be like, can you make a movie about this lamp? Okay.
Do you feel like that now in general? Do you feel like you can dictate? I do feel like playing, you know, Princess Bagansaya or wherever, and that, you know, I want to play FDR or whatever. You know. And somebody will say, yes, we'll give you money to do that. You're Jennifer Lawrence.
I want to play John Hughes.
Well, that would be not so hard.
Bob Hope. There's a lot of people I want to play. Yeah, I mean, I definitely feel like I have a lot more opportunities, but I don't really have like that like I want to play this character. I just kind of I'll read a script and I'll love it, and I'm like, this is what I want to do. I don't like get that kind of itch to do a certain thing, and I also am not ready for that responsibility of being able to be like, let's make this movie, let's put this together. Like, I would love to be that one day, but I'm not a grown up yet, so I can't. People will be like, they'll let me do it, but they shouldn't. I'm definitely not ready.
Do you want to be a grown up?
No, I'm just 22. I think that I don't want to be a grown up because I'm already such an old woman that I'd like to have the illusion that, like, I want to like keep staying out and keep partying. It's like,
yeah. But I think that's what works with you as a star. And I think that's the thing that people are drawn to in a way. There's this reality.
Yeah, you don't have to worry about me out every time. Even people from work, even producers will be like, you want to come out? And I'm like, I'm in my mouth guard in bed. It's 9.
Well, it's hard work.
Yeah, that's my excuse.
Waking up for a 5 a.m. call or a 6 a.m. call or all that stuff.
Yeah, 3 a.m. call that I had Tuesday.
3 a.m.?
Yeah.
Because they have to make
I can't
you
say
up.
That though. My brother made so we were, I was back in Kentucky and I said that and I was like, well, I had a midnight call time one time for Mystique, and he goes, oh, I'm sorry, it's really hard what you do, I bet they can find somebody else to do it. And I was like, now I can't brag about call times.
Is your entire family like that about it? Do they kind of keep you in line? Or
Yeah.
Do you need to be kept in line? Is that part of it?
Definitely. No, I've kept my friends and family have not changed at all. It's actually been really hard on my friends. I was laughing last night because my friend, when I first started getting recognized, we were like at a bar, and anytime anybody came up, I was like, "Are you Jennifer Lawrence?" She just would start snapping. She's like, "No!" And like started like ripping me away. And then one of my friends was, we were driving to breakfast and we were being followed by a paparazzi, and she got so overwhelmed that she had to pull the car over and was crying. And she was like, "Oh, no, how is this legal? We can't live like this. This is horrible." And I'm like, "It's okay."
You'll be
it's been
okay.
Really hard on my friends. Yeah, it's going to be okay. It's all right. But yeah, nobody's really, everything's kind of stayed the same.
With everybody?
Yeah.
And do you look to your family?
I mean, obviously not at like Hollywood parties. Those are completely different.
But it doesn't sound like you go to too many of them.
I don't. I was actually trying to picture one in my head, and I just pictured the rap party last night. It was the last one I went
Which
to.
Got hipper somehow after it was over. It was very strange because it became the Soho House again.
Yeah.
Like at some point, the clock struck midnight or whatever, and all of a sudden they were like, okay, you can't use your phones in here anymore.
Can't use your phones?
Yeah, apparently they have a rule, you can't use your phone.
Oh.
Or you can't take pictures.
I broke that rule.
Or do anything else.
Oh.
That's right, you've been bad.
I should go apologize
See,
to the Soho
edgy.
House.
You're so edgy.
I know, I'm a rebel.
That could be it, Jen Lawrence apologizes to the Soho House.
Yeah.
Like a huge
Sorry,
story.
I used my cell phone.
The National Enquirer would pay thousands of dollars, hundreds of thousands of dollars for the story.
To get there and then that story.
So you're now, you came here, just took a little break from work, from the middle of your movie?
I did, yeah, well, yeah, I did.
So
took
you're,
a hot minute.
Is it a hot minute that's good? Is it good to have the hot minute in the middle of things, or are you?
No, I normally, like, when I'm working, like, I want to be there. Like, I don't really like traveling too much when I'm mm-hmm. when I'm working, but it's obviously exciting because this is the first time I've, like, really done any press for this movie, and it's, like, nerve-wracking but so exciting because audiences are seeing it, and, you know, it's when you're proud of something, you want to talk about it.
Well, it's really the first time anybody's seen it, and they've really done a pretty good job of keeping it under wraps, and the audience was pretty crazed last night.
Oh,
very happy group.
That's so exciting.
Well, it's like an unexpected. I mean, David is so arch and so sardonic often that you don't necessarily expect it to be such a kind of big audience.
Well, that's
movie.
What you can't even put your finger on him. Like, he can do anything. He's got so many different, you know, look at Three Kings and I Heart Huckabees. Like, what? That's the same director.
Yeah. It's craziness. Yeah. And so you'll fly off tomorrow and.
I fly off today.
You fly off today. Till 3 o'clock call time.
No. I had the 3 o'clock call time.
Now
I don't know what's waiting for me, but it's going to be early. But I don't. It's okay.
And is it easier a second time around? Do you know the characters so well?
I don't know. I haven't really acted yet. I mean, we did one scene where I wasn't talking, so I haven't. I mean, I imagine it would be easier. Practice makes perfect.
Were you good in
I'm
the one
doing
scene?
It more.
Were you good in the one silent scene?
I nailed it. It was so good. It's amazing because we have like the same crew. It's mm-hmm. like all my buddies from last year. It's like going to the production office every day. It's like a surprise party. It's mm-hmm. so fun.
Well, I guess you'll have them probably around for the third one as well.
Yeah, I hope so.
To keep the family going.
Yeah.
Or the fourth one or the fifth one. I don't know. They're spending it out.
Unless they mess up.
They're going to keep on writing books. Unless they mess with Jen Lawrence.
Yeah. Don't. With me.
So you fire people off the set all the time?
Oh, all the time.
You're like, what is that key light doing there? I'm out of here.
You're done.
And are you conscious of those things at all? Are you like, are you aware of your key light, or are you just there doing the work and let them do their work?
Oh, you mean like lighting?
Yeah.
No, I have no idea.
Where
I wouldn't even know where to begin. No, I knew that this isn't good. I don't know anything about like lighting situations.
So when you're driving the car and the paparazzi are following, you don't do this?
You'd be surprised, because if you look at any pictures, any paparazzi pictures, I managed to do it.
Well, they do take the worst possible picture.
Ever. It's awful. I'm always like, God, it's such a cruel wake-up call. I can't look at those pictures. It's like, oh.
And have you sworn off the internet, or do you do any of that?
I'm kind of normal with it. If it's like, if I wore an outfit that I wasn't too sure about, I'll go on Google, check it out, and be like, I'm not going to wear that again. But I haven't, I don't really Google myself that often. That's kind of a masochistic thing to do.
And will you read the reviews for
one this? One time, 2 years ago, my friend who was looking at paparazzi pictures of herself, she was feeling guilty, so I Googled Jennifer Lawrence ugly to like make her feel better. And my mother saw it on my internet history, and she was like,
And the pictures came up.
What are
up.
You doing? Well, yeah, of course they came up. You should type, that's like a fun thing to do, actually. Jennifer Lawrence ugly is like.
Now Google will have like a big spike and people think yeah. Jennifer Lawrence ugly.
Yeah.
Well.
There's more of that than if you type in Jennifer Lawrence, like anything else.
And will you rap in time for the Oscars this year?
I don't know. We're supposed to wrap in November.
Is it weird to think about going back into that season again?
No, it's exciting. I can't wait to get all the screeners.
That's the best part of being an Academy member.
Yeah, that's like turned into like my family's Christmas. We all just like lay on the couch watching screeners for hours and hours.
Well, years ago, they actually tried a screener ban because they were worried about piracy.
Right.
And the big problem was everybody was angry because they Christmas and Thanksgiving.
That's, it like revolves around screeners.
Yeah.
I know.
Because you can get
Except everything. The problem is it's like artsy movies, so you can't really dictate your way through. There's some big hit or misses in those. Like, there's sometimes we're watching it and we're like, God, I just want to watch, like, I don't know.
And there's not even a picture on it, so you don't have a guide.
I know. Like, I don't have. So I need a picture on the case. I need to know what I'm dealing with.
It sounds like fun. Oh, everybody died in the first minute.
Yeah.